There are too many of us on this planet, and a planet B will not save us. The Earth is about 4.54 billion years old. Humans have been around for approximately 200,000 years. For most of our time on Earth, our population grew relatively slowly. However, once we started cultivating the land, the human population began to grow exponentially. By the time of the birth of Christ, it had reached 170 million. Then the number of humans grew even faster due to significant advancements in medicine and technology. With industrialization came more food and people started living longer. In the second half of the 18th century, the population doubled from 597 million to 1 billion. At the beginning of the 20th century, antibiotics and vaccines were introduced, reducing mortality. In just 200 years, the world's population grew dramatically to 7 billion. If the growth rate continues at the same pace, 11 billion people will inhabit the planet by the turn of the next century. Faced with these numbers, some are pulling their hair out, thinking about the environmental disasters already underway, while others believe that exponential population growth is a minor problem compared to the challenges we will face in the near future. They sometimes present arguments like the entire current world population could fit in Texas with the same population density as New York, implying that our planet is nearly uninhabited from their perspective. Where does the truth lie? And do we have the last chance to emigrate to other planets? Let's try to see things clearly. The second half of the 1960s was a period of booming nightmares about what awaited humanity. In 1966, for example, a writer named Harry Harrison published a science fiction novel titled Make Room, Make Room, describing a dystopian world where too many people were struggling for too few resources. The book became the basis for a 1973 film depicting a hellish future, Soylent Green. Do you remember it? However, no one has been more influential, or more terrifying, some would say, than Paul R. Ehrlich, a biologist at Stanford University. His 1968 book, The Population Bomb, sold millions of copies and argued that humanity was on the brink of an apocalypse due to geometric population growth. Dr. Ehrlich's opening statement was the verbal equivalent of a gut punch. The battle to feed all of humanity is over. He went on to predict that hundreds of millions of people would die of starvation in the 1970s, with 65 million of them being Americans, that crowded India was essentially doomed, and that by 1985 the planet would no longer be able to sustain humanity. Over half a century later, it seems that Ehrlich's predictions have been disproven by facts. None of what he foresaw in his book has come to pass. Earth is currently inhabited by 8 billion people, and everything seems to be working just fine. So what's the catch? In the same year the Population Bomb was published, on July 9, 1968 at the National Institute of Health in Bethesda, Maryland, scientist John Calhoun placed 8 white rats in a square enclosure measuring 2.7 meters long by 1.3 meters high. Thus began an experiment that would spark decades of discussion and influence ethologists, behavior psychologists, and researchers worldwide. However, on that summer day over half century ago, Calhoun had no knowledge of all of this. He was just a 50-something ethologist specializing in animal behavior. Like Ehrlich, he had realized that the world's human population was growing too rapidly, and he wanted to understand what could happen if the natural habitat became too small to contain us all. The rats chosen as subjects were the best specimens from the National Institute of Mental Health, NIMH. Does that acronym sound familiar? They were placed in an environment dubbed Universe 25, where there was no need to defend against predators or even produce food. No cats, no traps, no extreme temperatures, and no risk of being vivisected in experiments. In essence, the mice only had to focus on eating and reproducing. The initial days were characterized by exploring the territory and tumultuous social interactions. After that, relationships solidified and the population began to grow exponentially, doubling roughly every 2 months. The colony began to show signs of collapse in August of 1969, when the rat population reached around 600 individuals. Food and water continued to be abundant, but as predicted by Calhoun, there was a breakdown in social roles. Mating started to decline. Infant mortality reached 96%, including instances of cannibalism, and births ceased entirely. In this context, female rats stopped reproducing, and the few that did neglected their offspring. Many rats became aggressive, while others known as the beautiful ones withdrew to privileged positions, never seeking either mating or fighting. They ate, slept, and cared only for themselves in a narcissistic introspection. Some males attacked females and their offspring, while others became pansexual, attempting to mate with any available rat. The females, alone and in danger due to threats from males, sought refuge in higher niches, taking their offspring with them. However, they couldn't care for the young as they were too occupied with protecting their territory. Most of the offspring were left to die and no one cared for them. This led to the complete collapse of the Utopian Universe 25. After 2 years, the population began to decline, and the last birth occurred on March 1, 1970. The experiment ended 5 years after it began, with the total extinction of the rat society and the death of the last rodent. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. Okay, it's a gruesome and incredibly sad experiment, but what was that about the collapse caused by the lack of social roles? The Universe 25 experiment was born in response to Malthusian theories that exponential population growth would lead to extinction due to resource scarcity. Calhoun aimed to demonstrate that it wasn't food resources that were the problem, but the lack of available social roles for too many individuals. Indeed, the low mortality conditions, thanks to how Universe 25 was designed, resulted in the survival of an extensive number of individuals. Within a few generations, all available social roles in the physical space of Universe 25 were saturated. In human terms, this would be called lack of job opportunities, a sense of uselessness, and mass frustration. According to Calhoun, no matter how sophisticated man might become, once the number of individuals capable of filling social roles vastly exceeds the number of roles available, the result is the disruption of the social organization. But does the Universe 25 experiment truly foreshadow the fate of an overcrowded world? Opinions on this matter vary. At the heart of the objection is the difference between the subjects of the experiment, rats and humans. However, considering what's happening in our society today, where available roles are decreasing, despite no resource shortage, the differences seem minimal. Nevertheless, despite the danger posed by the sense of uselessness that pervades the lives of those who feel excluded in an increasingly competitive world, the explosive increase in the population appears to be considered the least of the global problems of our time. Some experts, evidently out of their minds, even claim that our planet could comfortably support up to 50 billion individuals. That's an extremely disheartening opinion, evoking visions of a termite-ridden planet where the entire surface is paved over and occupied by one colossal urban sprawl, a militarized society of small, artificially nourished automations. Achieving this nightmare would indeed come at such a price, and at the cost of the lives of billions of other creatures, because our species isn't the only one on this planet. And as the growth of the human population and its need for sustenance, energy, and wealth has sown devastation throughout the natural world. On land, in water, and in the skies, humans have hunted and pushed away every animal, destroying or shrinking their habitats, and in many cases deliberately eradicating species themselves. This has been done by both rich and poor nations, often for different reasons. Only by doing this have we managed to sweep the issue of overpopulation under the rug, by stealing, exploiting, and killing anything that crossed our path, as if resources were limitless. But now it seems the time has come to pay the bill. It's almost irrelevant that Ehrlich's specific predictions haven't yet materialized in the manner or time frame he originally proposed, denying that problems like population growth, inequality, malnutrition, pollution, global warming, and ocean acidification are current threats to our long-term survival means denying objective reality. So what to do? Well, the problem is incredibly complex, but at the nearly irreversible point we've reached, we can no longer afford to tackle it with nuanced philosophies. Birth control, sterilization, funding for family planning programs, making modern contraception legal, free, and available everywhere, even in remote areas, and most importantly, creating a demographic policy built around an optimal population size and working to achieve it are all necessary. One thing must be very clear, though. Whatever solution is applied must first and foremost be inspired by the ethical principle of environmental conservation and the recognition of equal dignity for all creatures of the earth. So, no more animal exploitation, a definitive closure of farms and slaughterhouses, and widespread use of synthetic meat. The goal? Drastically reduce the population over a century. A population of 3 billion people might be the right compromise to maintain a high level of inventiveness and the circulation of ideas while not excessively burdening the ecosystem. This might be everything we wanted to convey in this video, but there is one last point to make. During the 1960s and 70s, concurrent with the peak of the space age, scientists contemplated how humans might one day live in space. Among the many advantages, the migration of humans and industry to other celestial bodies seemed like a possible solution to overpopulation and environmental degradation. The question was, why worry about too many people on Earth when we have the entire universe to expand into? Hadn't Europe already solved its demographic problems by sending the excess population to the New World discovered by Columbus? So why couldn't we continue this process? Many scientists and proponents of space migration, from Stephen Hawking and Robert Zubrin to Elon Musk, have emphasized that becoming interplanetary is the only long-term defense against extinction. Whether the cause is anthropogenic, climate change, nuclear war, etc., or due to the impact of an asteroid, a gamma-ray burst, or some other cosmic phenomena, being bound to one place makes human civilization vulnerable. Okay, having a planet be available to escape cosmic danger sounds like a good idea, but it should be clear to everyone that not all Earth's inhabitants could be transferred to a hypothetical new planet. It would only be a means to save, let's say, 1,000 humans, giving our species a chance not to go extinct, but it certainly wouldn't save everyone. Similarly, we sadly have to abandon the idea that the problem of an overcrowded Earth can be solved simply with a massive migration. To debunk this possibility, just consider that currently the Earth's population is growing by approximately 80 million individuals every year. This means that if we wanted to maintain the current population, we'd have to transport 80 million people to Mars or the Moon every year. An utterly unfeasible endeavor, even with technology vastly more sophisticated than ours. In short, just to be clear, there's no escape. The solution to this immense and underestimated problem must be found within ourselves, in our willingness to change.